SOAP is an XML-based protocol for accessing web services over HTTP. It has some specifications which could be used across all applications. It was developed as an intermediate language so that applications built on various programming languages could talk easily to each other and avoid the extreme development effort. Hi everyone, this is Kavya from EduRaker. Welcome to today's session on SOAP web services tutorial. Before we begin, I'd like to address the agenda. Firstly, there'll be an introduction to SOAP web service. Moving on, we'll learn about the SOAP message structure. We'll move ahead and then install SOAP UI. We will also test SOAP web services. Then we will create a SOAP web service using AccessOne implementation. Finally, we'll conclude the session by discussing the various types of web service clients. I hope the agenda is clear. Kindly take up this time to subscribe to us and do not forget to hit that bell icon to never miss an update from the EduRaker YouTube channel. Also, to learn more about new trending technologies, visit our page, the link to which is given in the description box below. So, without much ado, let's get started. Introduction to SOAP Web Service. Before we begin, we have to understand what is web service. Web service is a standardized medium to propagate communication between the client and server applications on the World Wide Web. A web service is a software module that is designed to perform a certain set of tasks. Web services in cloud computing can be searched for over the network and can also be invoked accordingly. Now, when it is invoked, the web service would be able to provide the functionality to the client which invokes that particular web service. Modern-day business applications use a variety of programming platforms to develop web-based applications. Now, these applications may be developed in Java, others in .NET, while some in AngularJS, Node.js, etc. Most often than not, these heterogeneous applications need some sort of communication to happen between them. Since they're built using different development languages, it becomes really difficult to ensure accurate communication between applications. Here is where web services comes into picture. Web service provides a common platform that allows the multiple applications built on various programming languages to have the ability to communicate with one another. Now that we know what is web service, let's move ahead and understand how web service works. Now, the diagram shows a very simplistic view of how a web service would actually work. The client here would invoke a series of web service calls by a request to a server which would host the actual web service. Now, as an example, Amazon provides a web service that provides prices for products sold online via Amazon.com. We all know that. Now, the front end or presentation layer can be in .NET or Java, but either programming language would have the ability to communicate with the web service. Now, the main component of a web service design is the data which is transferred between the client and the server, and that is XML. That is Extensible Markup Language, which is a counterpart to HTML and easy to understand the intermediate language that is understood by many programming languages. So when applications talk to each other, they actually talk in Extensible Markup Language, that is XML. This basically provides a common platform for applications developed in various programming languages to talk to each other. Web services use something known as SOAP, that is Simple Object Access Protocol, for sending the XML data between applications. Now, the data is sent over normal HTTP. The data which is sent from the web service to the application is simply called as a SOAP message. We'll be discussing about the SOAP message structure later on in the session. Now, the SOAP message is nothing but an XML document. Now, since this document is written in XML, the client application calling the web service can be written in any programming language. Moving on to the next part of the session, we'll be talking about the types of web services that are available. Now, there are mainly two types of web service. The first one we've already mentioned, that is SOAP web services. And the second one is RESTful web services. Now, in order for a web service to be fully functional, there are certain components that need to be in place. Now, these components need to be present irrespective of whatever development language is used for programming the web service. Moving on, finally, let us understand what is SOAP web service. Now, in today's world, there are a huge number of applications which are built on different programming languages. For example, there could be a web application designed in Java, another in .NET, and another in PHP. This we've already discussed. Now, exchanging data between applications is crucial in today's networked world, but data exchange between these heterogeneous applications would be complex. So will be the complexity of the code to accomplish this data exchange. Now, one of these methods used to combat this complexity is to use XML as the intermediate language for exchanging data between applications. We have already talked about this. What you will have to remember is every programming language can understand the XML markup language. Hence, XML was used as the underlying medium for data exchange. But there are no standard specifications on use of XML across all programming languages for data exchange. And this is where SOAP software comes in the picture. SOAP was designed to work with XML over HTTP and have some sort of specifications which could be used across all specifications. SOAP is simply known as Simple Object Access Protocol, but in later times it was just shortened to SOAP version 1.2. SOAP is basically a protocol, or in other words, is a definition of how web services talk to each other or talk to client applications that invoke them. The beginning of the 21st century is remembered for the internet boom. Thousands of internet-driven companies were emerging and millions of users were accessing the web every day. Now imagine that a single server starts receiving thousands of requests from users, that is clients, simultaneously. And if this resource does something more complex than show walls of text, things can get a bit slow. Now, for instance, if users check the upcoming flight schedule and must drill down to each flight detail, the server must be aware of what's happening with the client, right? Now, it appears that you can handle the situation in two ways, using stateful and stateless operations, and SOAP supports both. Stateful means that the server keeps the information that it receives from a client across multiple requests. Now, for instance, first it memorizes the flight dates that you are looking for and then provides information on the pricing after the second request. This allows you to chain messages together, making the server aware of the previous requests. Stateful messaging may be crucial in operations involving multiple parties and complex transactions, example bank operations or flight booking, but still it is really heavy to be a server. Stateless communication means that each message contains enough information about the state of the client so that a server doesn't really have to be bothered with it. Now, once the server returns requested data, it forgets about the client. Each request is isolated from the previous one. Stateless operations help reduce server load and increase the speed of communication. Stateful operations is one of the reasons SOAP is used for bank transactions and other exchanges that require chaining messages. So when developing SOAP-based web services, you need to have some language which can be used for web services to talk with client applications. SOAP is definitely the perfect medium which was developed in order to achieve this purpose. This protocol is also recommended by the W3C Consortium, which is the governing body for all web standards. Now, since SOAP programming is based on the XML language, which itself is a lightweight data interchange language, hence, SOAP as a protocol that also falls in the same category. SOAP is designed to be platform independent and is also designed to be operating system independent. So the SOAP protocol can work on any programming language based applications on both Windows and Linux platforms. It works in the HTTP protocol, which is the default protocol used by all the web applications. Hence, there is no sort of customization which is required to run the web services built on the SOAP protocol to work on the World Wide Web. Now that we know so much about SOAP web services, let's move ahead and check out the SOAP message structure. Now, a SOAP message is encoded as an XML document consisting of an envelope element, which contains an optional header element and a mandatory body element. There is also a fault element contained in the body element, which is used for reporting errors. Now, we'll just talk briefly about the SOAP envelope, which is the root element in every SOAP message. It contains two child elements, an optional header, and a mandatory body. Now, the SOAP header is an optional sub-element of the SOAP envelope, which is used to pass application-related information that is to be processed by SOAP nodes along the message path. Now, the SOAP body, on the other hand, is a mandatory sub-element of the SOAP envelope, which contains information intended for the ultimate recipient of the message. Now, the SOAP fault, on the other hand, is a sub-element of the SOAP body, which is used for reporting errors. Now that we know the SOAP message structure, Let's move ahead and install SOAP UI and learn about its user interface. Now I'm just going to go to my web browser and type in SOAP UI. So the first link that turns up will redirect you to the official website of the SOAP UI. So I'm just going to click on that. And as you can see that this will redirect me to the official website of SOAP UI that is supported by SmartBear. And I'm just going to scroll down a bit and you can see that there's an option which says try Ready API for free. You can also see a menu on top and things like that. What we really need to do is we want to download the SOAP UI open source. So I'm just going to click on get started now. Now this will redirect me to a page which will allow me to download SOAP UI. I'm just going to click on download now. I'm going to scroll down and I'm just going to click on download SOAP UI open source. And this will automatically download my SOAP UI installer. So once the installation has been completed, I'm just going to click on the executable file. As you can see that there's a window that prompts you to install SOAP UI on your computer. So I'm just going to click next. And this is the folder where your SOAP UI will be installed. You can change it accordingly if you'd like to. And I'm just going to click next. And I'm just going to click next. And this is also the target directory for SOAP UI tutorials. So I'm just going to keep clicking next, next. And this will allow me to create a desktop icon, which is okay for me. I'm just going to click next. Once all of this is done, it will download SOAP UI on your computer. Once the installation process has been completed, you can just run SOAP UI. I don't want to view the release notes, so I'm just going to untick that and I'm just going to click finish. Now you can see the graphical user interface of your SOAP UI. So I've just clicked skip. I haven't entered my credentials. If you'd like to enter your credentials, you could. And you could also see the endpoint explorer. You can choose a method and enter a REST endpoint URL. Before we get to this, let us just check out the UI in general. You can see there is a list of menu on top. There's file where you can create an empty project. You can create a SOAP project. You can create a REST project. You can also import projects. You can rename workspaces. You can switch workspaces, you can create new workspaces here. And since we haven't imported or created any projects, these options have been blocked out or aren't showing up. But in the project option, you can add WSDL files, you can add WADL files, you can launch test runner, you can launch load test runners, you can launch different things, variety of different things. And you can also import Swagger, export Swagger. You can save your project here, you can reload your project here. And in the next option, there's suite, which will show you the test suite editor. You can also create new test case. You can clone your test suite. You can also launch test runner. You can also move test suite up and down. And in the next option, that is the case option, you can show test case editor. Also create new load tests, security tests, clone test cases. And you can really, you know, do a lot of things with these options. There is also the step option, which will allow you to open editor and also insert various steps. The tools option, on the other hand, really allows you to, you know, access many tools that are available on the SOAP UI interface. And the desktop option will allow you to switch windows, maximize desktop. And the help option, on the other hand, will just, you know, allow you to get some help, you know. You can also search forum. You can check out the SOAP UI Pro trial. You can really, you know, check out SOAP UI in general, understand it in detail using the help option. Moving on, we have the empty option, which will allow you to create an empty project. You can also create a new SOAP project, REST project. You can import an existing SOAP UI project into the current workspace that you're working in. You can also save all of the projects in your workspace that you're working on. And also, if you want to go to the SOAP UI forum in the browser, you can just click this and this will redirect you to the SOAP UI forum. That is the community where you can post all of your doubts and interact with them, okay? Once that is done, you also have this option called as preferences. This is pretty important because all of the HTTP settings, the proxy settings, the WSDL settings, the UI settings, and the global properties, all of the changes that you want to make can happen here. So this is really, really important, and this is slight bit complicated too. If you're really aware and if you really know how to handle web services, you can make the changes as you'd like. Else you could just leave the options in their default state. Now that we've talked about preferences, you can also set up your proxy. Right now it's on automatic, which is great. I'll just let that be. And you can also search forums. You can type any kind of doubts or questions that you have and then just search, which will redirect you to a web browser, and that web browser will give you the possible solutions. Now, moving on the left-hand side, you can see there's an option that says projects. Now, this option has two objects, okay? One is the property and one is the value. The property could be the name, the description, the file, project root, whereas the value is your value of the property, okay? So I hope that is clear. Now let's move ahead and test SOAP web service. Now before we move ahead, you will have to understand what a WSTL file is. Now for all of y'all who don't know, a WSTL file, or simply called as a web service description language, is an XML-based definition language, and it is used for describing the functionality of a SOAP-based web service. Now WSTL files are central to testing SOAP-based services. So these WSTL files are really important and define various aspects of SOAP messages, like whether any element or attribute is allowed to appear multiple times, or even the required or optional elements and attributes, and also a specific order of elements if it is required. So you may consider a WSTL file as a contract between the provider and the consumer of the service. So now that we know what a WSTL file is, we'll go ahead and, you know, import a WSTL file into the SOAP UI to test it. The most commonly used WSTL file on the internet is the calculator. So I'm just going to click WSTL calculator. So the first website will redirect you to this page, which says calculator and has some certain, you know, snippets of code and also the operations that is supported in the calculator. So if you want to review the entire WSTL file, just click on the service description option that's available here. And this will redirect you to the WSTL file. You can see that you have element name that says add. You have element name that says subtract, multiply, divide. So these are all the calculator operations that are present, as we all know. And if you scroll down, you also have the service name, which says calculator, and the port name. And you have all of the other information that is really important. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to copy this. And I'm just going to switch back to my SOAP UI. And I'm just going to click on create a new SOAP project. I'm just going to name my project calculator. And I'm just going to paste the URL. And I'm just going to leave this ticked, create sample request for all operations. I'm not going to create a test suite. And I'm also not going to store all file paths in project. So I'm just going to click OK. Now, once this is done, you can see that there is projects and you have a folder that is named calculator. The interesting part is that if you click on calculator SOAP 12, you can see the property and values change here. Okay, if you click add, you can see that the properties and values change. If you click divide, the properties and values change. So everything has its own unique property and value. Okay, and I'm just going to click on request one. What this will do is it will give me a snippet of code, which will allow me to pass two parameters, okay? So I'm gonna add two numbers here and let me just pass 100 and 200, okay? And I want to execute this request, okay? I want SOAP to execute this request. So I'm just going to click on this green play button that's present on the left-hand side. And as you can see that the output or the result has been displayed on the right-hand side, that's 300. So 100 plus 200 is 300, that's right. So this is great, right? The web service works and you can also play around. You can also send requests for divide. You can also send requests for multiply, subtract. You can do whatever you want to. And there are many WSTL files that are available online. You can also check them out. Moving on to the next part of the session, we learn how to create SOAP web service using AccessOne. Firstly, we will have to understand what is AccessOne. Apache Access is an implementation of the SOAP, that is Simple Object Access Protocol, submission to W3C. Access 1.1 has proven itself to be a reliable and stable base on which to implement Java web services. There is a very active user community, and there are many companies who really use Access for web services support in their products. So this is what Access One is. So to create SOAP web services using Access One, you will have to download JDK, Eclipse, Apache Tomcat, and also SOAP UI. And once you do that, you will have to add any application server to Eclipse. That's the first step. The second step is to create a dynamic web project. And once you're done with that, you will also have to create a service Java class within the source folder. And inside that particular class, you will have to create a method that you want to use as a service. Once you do this, you convert the service to the web service by using the correct implementation like Access One. And you then deploy the service to the server by stopping and restarting the server. Finally, you test the Whistle URL if the service is deployed properly or not by incorporating the URL in any web browser. So if you paste this URL in any web browser and if it works, that's great. Then finally, you test the service in SOAP UI. So until the deployment part, you will have to execute this in Eclipse. After that, you will have to test the service in SOAP UI. It's really that easy, you know, to create SOAP web service using Access One. Moving on to the last topic of this session, we will be discussing the types of web service client. Now, there are two types of web services client. The first one is proxy-based client. The second one is DII client. Now, if web service client is generating the stubs, or you can just call them as proxies in the client side, and the client uses it to invoke the web services, then it is a proxy-based client. Now, a stub for a remote object acts as a client's proxy, that is a local representative for the remote object. So what is its responsibility? It carries out the method that is called on the remote object, which is invoked by a caller to a method. On the other hand, we have the DII client, which is also called as the Dynamic Invocation Interface client. Here, the client never really creates the stubs or proxies. Instead, the application programming interface provider will give the stubs to call the web services. So with this, we come to the end of today's session on SOAP web services tutorial. I hope you had a great time. If you have any queries, leave them in the comment section below and we'll get back to you as soon as possible. Until next time, thank you.
I hope you have enjoyed listening to this video. Please be kind enough to like it, and you can comment any of your doubts and queries, and we will reply them at the earliest. Do look out for more videos in our playlist and subscribe to EduReka channel to learn more. Happy learning!